Good evening. Thank you to all of you for making the time to come to this annual London School of Theology lecture that's sponsored by Deo Gloria, Glory to God. I did a little bit of research about both Deo Gloria and LST. Well, that's not quite right, really. It's like when the Queen says, "We did the garden." She obviously didn't do the garden, did she? Susie, who's on our staff, did the research. But I read all her research. So you got to work sharper, not harder. But what I liked about Deo Gloria Trust, it says this: the Deo Gloria Trust seeks to promote the good news about Jesus Christ and to encourage Christians to share it with others. And as soon as I read that, that warmed my heart. And since 1965, the Deo Gloria Trust has initiated and supported numerous evangelistic projects. So it's great, because I always like to know a little bit about who the partners are, who the sponsors are. Now, London School of Theology mission statement says, "The London School of Theology is an evangelical academic learning community called to equip and encourage one another to be disciples of Jesus Christ." And I absolutely love that. That really is what Christians are about. And we're about making disciples. Now, this has been promoted as a lecture. And so we did a bit of research on that, because I thought, oh dear, it's a lecture. What's the difference between a lecture, a talk, and a speech? So we researched all these different dictionaries to find what the difference was between the three. And surprisingly, they're all the same. Apart from, in a lecture, you can read your notes. So I've just read a bit, so that would qualify this as being a lecture, even if I don't read anything else. So, but maybe later on I'll read a little bit more, so it really is a kosher lecture. People often ask me, "J.John, what do you do?" And it's always very, very difficult to know what to say to people. Because, you know, if I say to people that I'm a reverend, which I am, that conjures up images in people's minds as to what I might be. You know, if I say to people that I'm a canon in the Church of England, which I am, you know, what does that mean? You know, it's like, I'm not really sure myself. For a number of years, I haven't wanted to use the word evangelist. Now, this is very interesting, because for many, many years, I think for the last 20 years, we haven't liked using the word evangelism or the word evangelist. We kind of feel that these words are not very seeker-sensitive, and so we'd rather use other expressions. One of my former assistants, Chris Russell, who's now the advisor on evangelism to the Archbishop of Canterbury, we've actually had some very good assistants who've gone on to various places, including Jamie Bennett, who was our assistant, who's now working at the London School of Theology. So I joked with him earlier on that when he arrived to be our assistant, he was useless. But when he left, he was brilliant, and all nicely shaped, nicely mentored, and we've given him to the London School of Theology. And the London School of Theology have given us another assistant, who is Susie, who's with us, and we're shaping her up. She's actually very good. But the great thing about having assistants... Yeah, did that sound like she was better than Jamie? But anyway, there we are. No, they're all great, but we've passed them all on to others. Anyway, back to the story. My former assistant, who's now the advisor of evangelism to the Archbishop of Canterbury, Chris Russell, recently said to me that he also is a vicar of a church in Reading, that a member of his congregation who works for Microsoft gave him his business card, and the title of his job at Microsoft is Evangelist. I couldn't believe it. And when I heard that, I thought, no, Microsoft cannot hijack our word. It's our word. But what's so funny is, it is our word. It's a New Testament word, and we're too embarrassed to use it. So I've decided I'm going to start using it, irrespective of what people think or say, what it could mean, and the connotations that that word has. So, back to the story. People say, what do you do? So, how do you explain what do you do? Well, I sat next to this lady on an aeroplane at Heathrow Airport, and I said, hello? And she said, oh, hello. And I said, where are you going? She said, Singapore. Then she said to me, where are you going? I said, I'm going to Australia. And I said, what do you do? So she told me. And then she said, what do you do? And I said, well, I work for a global enterprise. She said, do you? I said, yes, I do. I said, we've got outlets in nearly every country of the world. She says, have you? I said, yes, we have. I said, we've got hospitals, hospices, homeless shelters. We've got orphanages. We do justice work, reconciliation work, marriage work, educational work. I said, basically, we look after people from birth to death, and we deal in the area of behavioral alteration. And she went, wow! I mean, like, really, really loud, wow! And people turned and looked at us. And she said, what's it called? I said, it's called the church. Have you heard of it? But you know, when you think about it, what are we? You know, what is the London School of Theology? What's it about? What's the DNA of it? What's the DNA of Deo Gloria? What's the DNA of the church? What's the DNA of the Christian? Well, we're involved in a global enterprise. It's a global thing about transforming people's lives. That's what we're about. Do you know, I went to theological college, St. John's College in Nottingham. Initially, when I first went there, it was like, oh, why am I here? You know, and I found it quite initially adjusting to a different rhythm and study and everything else. And it was only kind of halfway through that I began to appreciate what it was all about. Basically, God pulls us in so that he can then push us out. And it's really good to have a time to be pulled in so that we can be pushed out. I'm a great advocate to study theology. I think that Jesus, he spent 30 years preparing for 3 years of ministry. So we can at least spend 1 year or 2 years or 3 years preparing for 30 years of ministry. It really is good. While I was there, I don't think I realized the benefits of studying theology. It's only as I look back in hindsight, how much I did learn and how much I grew as a person. And I was pulled in so that I could be pushed out. The Great Commission states this, Matthew 28, verse 19. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I'm with you always to the very end of the age. Now, I'm Greek. I'm bilingual in Greek. So I can read the New Testament in Greek. And when I was at theological college, it was so funny. I remember week one, we would study Romans in Greek. And obviously nobody else could read Greek. And so, you know, I'd read and translate Romans in Greek. And I had interesting conversations with the lecturer because he would tell me that I'm not reading it correctly. And I said, well, actually, I don't think you're reading it correctly because I'm kosher Greek. And I know how to read it, but you've learnt it when you've learnt it in the wrong way. And so we used to have a lot of banter about that. Now, you know when a lot of preachers say the Greek means this? It usually doesn't. I sometimes look at it and go, it doesn't say that at all. Anyway, so I'm going to do a little bit of Greek for you here so that, you know, but by the way, when I do a little bit of Greek, you can believe me. Okay? You can actually believe me, right? So when I read to you the Great Commission, therefore go, okay? The word go, okay? Now, the Greek word for go means go. You know, just in case you thought it may not have meant that, maybe there was another meaning. Maybe there's a different interpretation. The Greek word for go means go. It actually means go. Now, if any of you do Instagram, Twitter, or anything like that, I'm Canon J.John, okay? If I say anything really good, tweet it. You know, or put it on Instagram. Let's go viral. Let's go viral on this, okay? So if I say anything good, tweet it. Don't worry if you're not sure if it's good. I'll tell you when it's really good, and then you know that's really good, worth tweeting, okay? This next thing's really good. We must be global Christians with a global mission because we have a global God. Okay, repeat after me. We must be global Christians with a global mission because we have a global God. Even Winnie the Pooh said, you don't have to repeat that. Even Winnie the Pooh said, you can't stay in your corner of the forest waiting for others to come to you. You have to go to them sometimes. So even Winnie the Pooh got it. C.S. Lewis wrote, the salvation of a single soul is more important than the production or presentation of all the epics and tragedies in the world. Evangelism, in the biblical sense, is concerned with individuals and their relationship to God, and also their relationship and responsibility to others. Service, worship, education, pastoral care, and evangelism are bound together in the one mission. The mission of the church is to restore all people to unity with God and each other in Christ. Now, we don't like to share. And, you know, this goes back years and years throughout our lives. I mean, you know what happens? Parents will buy a new toy for their child. And they'll give the child this new toy, and the child is just ecstatic. And then the parents ruin it. And they say, now, share it with others. And the kid's thinking, are you mad? you want me to share this new toy you've given me? And I think we grow up with this thing of not wanting to share. You know, sometimes my wife, Killy, and I, you know, it's a day off or something, and, you know, we'll go to a restaurant or something, and, like, we look at the menu, and I think, oh, fancy a burger. Burger, oh, fries, really fancy that. And then my wife's being a typical woman, oh, she'll have a salad, do you see? So the salad's there, I got my burger, I got my fries, and she goes, oh, can I have a fry? I said, no, you could have ordered them. You didn't order them, they're my fries. Why do you want my fries? You see, there's this reluctance, isn't there, to share. And it's always, and I think in many other areas of our lives, we have this kind of reluctancy. We're talking about something completely different. There was a disabled man who couldn't get himself to Jesus. So four friends carried this disabled man to where Jesus was. The house was full of people. There were people outside the house. There was absolutely no way the four friends could carry a stretcher through the crowd of people to get him to Jesus. I reckon they must have stepped back, laid down their friend, and like, what are we going to do? Looked at the scenario, looked at the situation. I think they started to think out of the box. They thought, there's one way. There's only one way. It's going to be really difficult, but we can do this. Why don't we take off the roof? Now, that's a job in itself. Just take off the roof. It's not your house. I mean, can you imagine coming to your house and there's somebody up the roof and they're just taking the tiles off? What are you doing? I'm just taking the, you know, it's... And then they've got to come down, they've got to pick up their friend on a stretcher and somehow climb up the house while with the stretcher, get him up there and eventually lower their friend down in such a way that there was no way Jesus could miss it. Let's lift the roof of our thinking to get people to Jesus. Let's lift the roof of our thinking to get people to Jesus. Let's do everything we can to get people to Jesus. Whatever it takes, get people to Jesus. Irrespective of how we will look, be perceived. I reckon people must have been mocking them when they saw them trying to get through the roof. What are you doing? You're mad. But they risked everything to get him to Jesus. And look what happened. Was it worth it? Of course it was worth it. There are two reasons why people don't know Jesus. One, they have never met a Christian. Two, they have met a Christian. Those are the two reasons. They're the two most common reasons why people are not yet Christians. They have either never met a Christian or it's because they have met a Christian. We can make the difference. So many Christians have taken literally what Jesus said to three disciples, see that you tell no one. You know, so many Christians are like Arctic rivers. We're frozen at the mouth. And a lot of Christians are like, They perceive their evangelism as, let's put the sign of the fish on the back of a car and let's honk for Jesus. Yes, but when a non-Christian sees a car with a sign of the fish on the back of the car, they don't think of a Greek word, ichthos. Oh, that's ichthos. That stands for Jesus Christ, God's Son, Saviour. I don't think they think that. They look at the sign of the fish and they think, oh, they probably belong to an angling society. But they actually don't know which one it is. We can make all the difference. We can make all the difference. Christians are the light of the world, but the light has to be switched on. It's got to be switched on. We Christians are meant to be good news. The Apostle Paul, Romans 1, verse 16, "For I am not ashamed of this gospel of Christ. It is the power of God at work, saving everyone who believes." A true Christian is neither ashamed of the gospel nor ashamed to the gospel. A missionary is not someone who crosses the sea. A missionary is someone who sees the cross. That was really good. Repeat after me. A missionary is not someone who crosses the sea. A missionary is someone who sees the cross. In the words of the Apostle Paul in 1 Corinthians chapter 4, it's the love of Christ that compels me. The love of Christ compels me to seek and save the lost. Just imagine. Well, actually, I'll tell you a true story. My wife and I got three sons. And when our firstborn was very little, two, Killy and I, with Michael, it was Virgin Megastore. We were down in the basement, we were just looking at a few things, and then next second, he was gone. It's an unbelievable feeling. At that moment, you can't find your child. And we just went mental, running around, shouting, "Michael, Michael, Michael," couldn't find him. I ran up to the next floor. I started running around, shouting, "Michael, Michael, Michael." I went to one of the counters and I said to the lady, "Have you got a tannoy?" She says, yes, we have. I said, "I want to use it." She says, "You're not allowed to use it." I said, "Give it to me now." I grabbed it and I'm like, "Michael," I'm like, I couldn't care less what anybody thought of me. Why? My son was lost. Why would I care? Why would I care what people thought of me? "Oh, you're making a fool of yourself, J.John." Why would I care? My son was lost. Would I not do everything I can to try and find my lost son? That's the kind of analogy that the Bible uses to inspire us and encourage us to seek and to save the lost. People are lost. There's an urgency. We know the truth. Acts 1, verse 8. "You will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the ends of the earth." Now, I know, of course, the Holy Spirit was given at the first Pentecost and every day since. For many reasons, I know that. I know that the first Pentecost was a saving event, where the Spirit applied to our lives what Jesus did on the cross. I know that the Holy Spirit was a moral event, applying to our hearts the fulfillment of Jeremiah's prophecy that God's law would be written on our hearts. I know all that. But it was a missionary event. The Holy Spirit came then, the Holy Spirit comes now, in order for us to be witnesses. The Greek word for witness is marturia, from which we derive the word martyr. Our witness always carries the seed of the martyr. 2 Timothy 3 verse 12, everyone who wants to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will suffer persecution. Now, we are not told to provoke it or to invite it, but we are told to expect it. Our fear of rejection and losing reputation seems trifling when compared to some of our brothers and sisters who have lost lives and literally feared physical harm when they stood for Jesus Christ. I've spent my whole life as a Christian. I became a Christian. I was a student at Hendon College, and my first day of term, this guy comes up to me called Andy Economides, and he said to me, "Are you Greek?" I said, "Yes, I am." And he said, "I'm Greek." So it's like Greek, Greek, kebab, kebab, and like that was that. But that, what was interesting is there was the Greek connection. And what are you studying? We had a little conversation. And then he said to me, "I'm a Christian. Are you?" I said, I don't know. I don't know what a Christian is." Isn't that interesting? So we got the Greek thing out the way. We got the what course out of the way. He's straight in. "I'm a Christian. Are you?" "I don't know." And over a period of time, he explained it to me. At my baptism, I said this: "My friend Andy built a bridge from him to me. And when he did, Christ Jesus walked over it." And he showed me on the 9th of February, 1975, he showed me in the last book of the Bible, Revelation, chapter 3, verse 20, he read to me those verses, the picture of Jesus standing outside of a door knocking. And it says, if you hear the knock, open the door, let Jesus in. And Andy read this to me, and he said, "Have you heard Jesus knocking?" I said, "I think so." He said, "Have you opened the door?" I said, "Where's the door?" "I don't know where the door is." He said, "Don't worry about it. Just ask Jesus to break the door down." Yeah, look how simple he was. Look how creative he was. Look how just that. I got that. That night, I knelt beside my bed. I don't know why I knelt. It's the first time I'd ever knelt in my life. I thought that that's probably what you had to do, to pray. And I said, "Jesus, if you're knocking on my door, could you break the door down?" And at that moment, something happened. My heart, in the words of John Wesley, was strangely warmed. Now, I didn't know what that was. I didn't have the vocabulary. But I knew something had happened. Something. Something warmed my heart. My mind was illuminated. Something was different. It was different. My mother said to me that I was brainwashed. And I said, "Mum, my brain has been washed. If you only knew, Mum, what was in my brain, you'd be pleased it got washed." Do you know, I've thought on many, many occasions, If Andy had never introduced me to Jesus, what would I be doing now? Now, of course, maybe someone else may have come and told me. Maybe not, because I lived in London all my life, and he was the first person to ever tell me about Jesus. No one else ever told me about Jesus. Changed my life, changed my future, changed everything that one day. The next day, I walked to college. As I was walking to college from where I lived, it was about a mile, I saw a homeless man. I stopped and I said, "Have you had breakfast?" He said, "No." I said, "Would you like breakfast?" He said, "Yes." I said, "I'll take you for breakfast." So I took him for breakfast. I said, "Where do you hang out?" He said, "You know where you met me? That's where I hang out." I said, "No, where do you normally hang out?" He says, "You know where you met me? That's where I hang out." He goes, "I'm there in the mornings and then I go to the library in the afternoons." And I thought, if he's telling me the truth, that meant Monday to Friday, September, October, November, December, January, I walked past him and I never saw him. My first day as a follower of Jesus, and I'm seeing homeless people. I was like, whoa. I said, "Listen, would you like breakfast once a week?" He goes, "I love breakfast once a week." He said, "Can I bring my friends?" I was like, "What do you mean you want to bring your friends? It's like we think the homeless people don't have friends." Anyway, so we agreed he could bring four friends. So we started the breakfast club. And I said, "But here's the deal. You can all have breakfast, but you've got to listen to me teach you the Bible." And he's like, "Oh, yeah, we like the Bible. We like the Bible." So week one, I mean, I can still remember my talk week one was, "God is good. The devil, very bad, very bad." And then week by week, they got a little bit longer as I understood a few more things. And then I went to the college. I found Andy. I said, "Andy, Jesus broke the door down." And he goes, "That's brilliant." He says, "Look, I need to go to a lecture. I'll see you at lunchtime." So then I went to a lecture. I sat next to my friend Richard Gamble. I said, "Richard, I met Jesus last night." I said, "Did you?" I said, "I did." I said, "Have you met Jesus?" He says, I don't think I have, actually." I said, "Would you like to meet Jesus?" And you've got to remember, I hadn't joined the church yet to find out you weren't supposed to do this. Just a little bit of sarcasm there. And he said, I would like to know Jesus. I said, look, to really know Jesus, and I started to explain it to him, and I took him through Journey into Life. And I said, "You've got to pray this prayer. So would you want to do that?" So Richard prayed the prayer. So I said, "Listen, you've got to come and meet this guy called Andy." So we went to meet Andy. And then I said, "Andy, Richard, he knows Jesus." And Andy said, "Well, oh, Richard, I'm sorry I've not met you before. You know, how long have you been a Christian?" And it was like, 32 minutes or something. So then the three of us, we went to the student union to register the new Christian union. And Andy became the president, Richard was the treasurer, and I was the secretary. So I was the secretary of the Christian Union. So my first day as a Christian, I am the secretary of the Christian Union. Talk about motivation. It's like secretary of the Christian Union. Yeah, it's me, isn't it? It's me. And then my friend Harun Kala was the president of the Islamic Society. So I said, "Harun, we want to come and study the Quran." And he said, "Do you?" I said, "Yes." I said, "We want to learn all about Islam." And that was on a Friday. So three of us and two lecturers, we went to Islamic studies on a Friday. And I said, "But listen, next Wednesday we're starting Christian Union. So we're all come to Islamic studies, and you all come to Christian Union because it's really good for interrelations and all of that." Well, we did really well because five of us went to Islamic studies and 70 fundamentalist Muslims came to Christian Union. So in our Christian Union meetings, they were Muslims, Hindus, Jews, Buddhists. I mean, we had the whole lot. And I was secretary. So I said to the curate of my church at Christ Church North Finchley, I said, Patrick, he's called Patrick Springfield. I said, Patrick, I'm secretary of the Christian Union. I said, like, who are the best speakers in London, the best ones? And so he gave me a whole list of speakers, and I jotted their names, and, you know, be a bit like John Stott, All Souls. All right, okay. I mean, I'd never heard of John Stott. I'd only just heard of Jesus. And so the following week, I got these phone numbers. And then I rang up All Souls Langham Place. I rang up All Souls. Lady answered. I said, can I speak to John, please? And she's like, you know, John who? I said, oh, John. And I didn't know how to pronounce Stott. And I thought it was like Stoat. You mean Dr. Stott? Oh, okay. All right. Then can I speak to Dr. Stott? Well, what's it about? Well, can he come next Wednesday and speak at the Christian Union? She never put me through. Anyway, years later, I told John Stott that story. And John Stott apologized that the call was never put through to him. And he said, I would have come. He did. He actually said, I would have come. And so I just went on from there. Now, so since those days, I've thought about evangelism. I've thought about the priority of evangelism. I've thought about it. I've studied it. I've lectured on it. I've written books on it. And this is my conclusion. The church is essentially about three things. Look up, worship. Look in, well-being. Look out, witness. That's what we do. That's what the church does. Worship, well-being, witness. But all research indicates that the church spends over 95% of all of its time, energy, money, resources on worship and well-being. Would you not think, based on that statistic, that there's a slight imbalance? So when we say the priority of evangelism, we're not saying let's not do worship. We're not saying let's not do well-being. We're not saying that. What we're saying is, hey, let's drop the statistics a bit. 33% for worship, 33% for well-being, and 33% for witness. Because at the moment we're doing less than 5%. Make it a priority. I joke with my friend Matt Redman. I say, Matt, when we get to heaven, we're going to worship for eternity. But when we get to heaven, we're not going to be able to evangelize. So why don't we do a little bit less worship down here? We'll just do a little bit less. I honestly don't think God's going to be upset. I don't think he's got an identity issue here. You know, he's quite secure in himself. So why don't we do less worship and more witness? Let's make evangelism a priority because it currently isn't. It isn't. You look at most churches, you analyze the staff makeup of most churches. They're all employed for worship and well-being. No one's there responsible for witness. Now, I know this is an LST annual lecture, and I probably must only say nice things, but actually, I think it is appalling that LST does not teach evangelism. And for those of you that are on the board, for those of you that lecture there, I am shocked. I am saddened. And all I can say to you is this: what's wrong with you? What is wrong with you? All theology is about the glory of God. How can you be concerned about the glory of God and not be concerned about the billions of people who are perishing? So I'm sorry, I'm not going to be British because I'm a citizen of heaven. You get evangelism onto your curriculum. You make sure that if any student goes there for 1 year or 2 years or 3 years, they will at least have some opportunity to be inspired, equipped, and trained in evangelism. Because being a disciple, which is what we're talking about, it's about knowing Christ and making him known. So I would say to the LST staff, the council, you have no excuse. I actually find it a disgrace that you don't have evangelism on your agenda. And I would urge you and I would encourage you to put this right. You've got to train your students in evangelism because people are so ineffective today. Do you know, I was saddened last night. We took some friends out for dinner to a favorite restaurant near where we live. And we've got to know the owners of the restaurant. And we've been encouraging them in their journey of faith. And he told us that last Sunday, they thought, right, we're going to do that. We're going to do what J.John and Killy have said. We're going to go to church. So they've got a baby. So they're all ready, going to go to the local church, and the baby was a little bit sicky, so they had to change her outfit. So that delayed them by a few minutes. They arrived there 5 minutes late, and the doors of the church were locked. So they went sideways, and they're gesturing to people inside the church. Can you open the door? Can you? And nobody would open the door. They bolted the doors. I was like, no, no. I felt so embarrassed. Make it a priority. Make it a priority. Let's inspire, let's equip, let's motivate people. Because we've been commissioned. We've been commanded to do this, and we're not doing it, and we're doing it ineffectively. My conclusion is this. It's very simple. We can sometimes complicate things, but actually evangelism is incredibly simple. And my conclusion, having been a practitioner in evangelism, and having studied it and lectured it and all of that, this is my conclusion. It's simple. How are we going to reach the lost? We're going to do it three ways. One, by praying. One, by praying. Two, by caring. Two, by caring. Three, by sharing. Three, praying, caring, sharing. Praying, caring, sharing. That's it. Well, that can't be difficult, can it? That cannot be difficult. So, when the Holy Spirit was given, Acts 1, verse 8, the Holy Spirit empowered the first believers to be witnesses, first in Jerusalem. What did Jerusalem represent? Well, that was where the disciples denied Jesus. Peter denied Jesus publicly. Where were they at the crucifixion? Only John was there. Jesus says, boys, start in the place of your greatest failure. Where is that for you and me? Family, friends, neighbors, colleagues. In other words, if we're going to reach the world, we've got to reach our world. We've got to reach our Jerusalem. So what we need to do is to identify our friends, neighbors, colleagues, relatives who don't yet know Jesus and intentionally pray for them. intentionally pray for the kingdom of God. I frequently ask Christians, do you pray for your friends, neighbors, colleagues, and relatives who don't know Jesus? If I ask that question 20 times, 19 will say no. One in 20 will say, I do. You see, so we're not even praying for a lost world. We're not even praying for the people we know. So let's pray in the kingdom. My wife and I pray for people every morning and every evening. We've done this for years. Last week, actually, I was curious because we keep adding people to our little list. And I was just intrigued to know how many we're actually praying for. And I counted them last week. So my wife and I pray for 33 people who don't yet know Jesus, and we pray for them every morning and every evening. It doesn't matter, you know, however tired I am, I still brush my teeth before I go to bed. However tired I am, I still pray. However, you know, we do it as it's part of our thing, praying in the kingdom. Now, when you're praying for people, you can't pray for them and not care. Praying leads to caring. So my wife and I, we were walking around where we live, the community, just walking, praying, and I saw this woman. And I said to my wife, is that woman the lady that lives about seven doors up from us, who's a single mother, who's got a sick son? And Killy said, I think it is. And at that moment, you have a battle going on in here. And the battle is, shall I, shan't I? Can I be bothered, not be bothered? You have this little battle. Do you know, now, whenever I get a quiver in my liver, I just do it. And the reason I do it, in case, it is the Holy Spirit. Just in case. So I walk up to the woman, I say, excuse me, are you Barbara? She says, yes, I am. She says, you're J.John, aren't you? I said, yes, I am. She says, you're a minister, aren't you? I said, yes, I am. I said, I'm sorry, Barbara, but I heard that you have a son and he's sick. Yes, he's dying. Can you go now to the hospice and pray for him? And I thought, what does she think I do all day? You know, humanity kicks in, doesn't it? It's like, does she think I don't do anything? I've got nothing to do. Let's just go to a hospice. He's dying. What's more important than that? Of course we can go. We have to walk home, pick up the car, find out where the hospice is, drive to the hospice, find it, find where he is. He was sleeping. My wife goes, oh, he's sleeping. Look, let's leave it. We'll go and come back later. I said, no, I'm not coming back later. So I kicked the bed really hard. But like, I kicked it so hard, I dead-legged my leg. It was like, ah! He woke up. He's 32 years of age. And he looks at us. And I said, hi. I said, Johnny. I said, we've just met your mother. And I said, I'm a minister, and your mother asked me to come and pray for you. Would you like that? And then when I said that, right, there's this gentleman just in front of me here, right? He looked at me straight in the eyes like that. It was so uncomfortable. And I'm like, oh, Jesus, help me. Well, it's like, even this gentleman's finding it awkward now, because he's like, he doesn't know whether to turn left, right, and we've got eye contact now, and it's like, awkward. And I just like, oh, Lord, help me. And it went on. And then he said, I'd rather have a hug. So Killy and I leaned down. He kind of lifted himself up. We've never met him before. The three of us are locked. And he starts crying. He's 32. Killy's crying. I start crying. And we hold each other. And then eventually he let go. And we laid him down. I said, well, do you want the prayer anyway? And he said, well, I'm an atheist, but if you need to do that, do it. Which was interesting, isn't it? So I said, okay, I'll say a little prayer for you. So I put my hand on his heart and I just kept silent. I didn't pray out loud. I didn't go all Pentecostal. Ooh! Ooh! She came on a Honda. She came on a Honda? When did she come on a Honda? Ooh, rubber dinghy. Rubber dinghy? What rubber dinghy was that then? No, I didn't become all Pentecostal about it. I didn't say anything. But in my heart, I was praying, Lord, warm his heart, warm his heart. And then I just said, amen. I said, would you like me to visit you again? He goes, I'd like that. So I kept visiting him. When we first met him, he was like minus 100. And I kept visiting him, kept talking. And then I went one occasion, and I don't know, something happened. His countenance changed, completely changed. The next morning, knock on our door, open the door, it's the mother. She's crying. He died last night. She said, would you speak at the funeral? Well, of course I'll speak at the funeral. I didn't realize that he was a famous club DJ. And at the funeral, there were 800 people at the funeral. I finished speaking. The service finished. I stepped down. People just went flocked. People were talking to me here. And people were pulling my arms, trying to get my attention. Mr. John, what did you mean? What did you mean you can get to heaven via King's Cross? You know, people say they don't know how to do evangelism. Okay? I'm just walking the streets. Your kingdom come. Your will be done. Come on, Lord. Break into this community. Lord, come. We're desperate for a revival. We're desperate for revival. Come. Quiver in your liver. Ooh, is that the woman who's got a sick child? Can I be bothered? Not bothered. Shall I? Shan't I? Go. Can you go and pray for my son? Okay. Go and pray for the son. Go and visit him. Jesus said to Zacchaeus, you know, interesting, the word Zacchaeus means pure. Everyone thought he was impure. He probably was, but Jesus could see that he could be pure. He goes, I'm going to come to your house today. Jesus did home visits. That's pretty encouraging. Well, he's the Son of God. Didn't he have anything more important to do? No, I'm going to go and do a home visit today. It takes time. And as a consequence of that, I address 800 people about Jesus. Who knows what could have happened as a result of that? Praying leads to caring. Our next door neighbors, they're not Christians yet. They call Killy and I the neighbors from heaven. Well, that's pretty good, isn't it? Well, we wouldn't want to be called the neighbors from the other side, would we? And the lady next door had a stroke. And as a consequence of the stroke, she fell into a coma. And as a consequence of that, the family came round and said, we've met with the doctors. Well, she had to get transferred to another hospital, John Ratcliffe in Oxford. And they said that she's brain dead. And in 5 days, they're going to turn off the life support machine. So Killy said, can we visit her before you turn off the machine? And they said, oh, would you? Because she was so fond of you. The only day we could go was the fifth day. And I'm like, oh, God, I can't believe she got transferred to Oxford, you know, because it's inconvenient. Do you know, evangelism can be inconvenient. It can be inconvenient. Anyway, we go there, we find it. She's in intensive care in this room. We open the door. As we open the door, two nurses walk out. We walk in. I say, hey, it's the neighbors from heaven. Killy's going, be quiet, we're in intensive care. What's wrong with you? Oh, yeah. Anyway, so I start talking to her. So I say, now listen, we're going to pray. So I got hold of her hand, held Killy's hand, Killy held her other hand. I said, we're going to pray the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come. And when we said, your kingdom come, she woke up. She's home. Look, we live in a world of miracle and mystery. You don't need to study too much theology to understand that. We live in a world of miracle and mystery. Christians are an Easter people living in a Good Friday world, but it feels like Easter Saturday. We're struggling with the tension of a broken world and the resurrection. We prayed for Johnny, he died. We said the Lord's Prayer, she woke up. I don't know. Well, I'm happy. I'm happy to pray for everybody. Everybody. It's God who does the rest. Let's be people who pray. Let's be people who care. And let's be people who share the good news. One of the great passages is John chapter 4, where Jesus, and it says he's here. He's at this point, A, and he needs to go to B. Jews who wanted to do that journey would walk around Samaria. But Jesus walked through Samaria. He broke long-standing traditions. Just because the Jews walked around Samaria, it didn't mean he had to do that. So he broke long-standing traditions, and he meets a woman at a well. Jesus and the woman, what were the barriers? Well, first of all, he's the high priest. She's living in adultery. So we've got a moral barrier. Then he's a man. She's a woman. We've got a social barrier. He's Jewish. She's Samaritan. So we've got a racial barrier. He's Jewish. She's Samaritan. We've got a religious barrier. So we've got moral barrier, social barrier, racial barrier, religious barrier. They've got nothing in common. Yes, they do. They've got one thing in common, H2O. She wants H2O. He wants H2O. Ah, yeah, what kind do you like? Fizzy or still, you know? What's your favorite, Evian? It was the equivalent conversation, H2O. And then by talking about H2O, water, he talks about living water. He speaks prophetically into her life. Woof! The first time she speaks to Jesus, she says Jew. But when you read it in its context, it's a bit more like Jew. The second time she speaks to him, she goes, sir? The third time she speaks to him, she goes, prophet? The fourth time she speaks to him, she goes, Messiah? And what happens when we meet people? They like us. And then 20 minutes later, they don't. And she went from Jew to sir, to prophet, to Messiah. What a chapter. I mean, that's one worth looking at. Praying, caring, sharing, helping people. You know, we don't have to wake up in the mornings and go, where are the non-Christians? They're everywhere. They are everywhere. I came back from Singapore. The flight was midnight. I said to my wife, what we'll do is we'll eat before we get on the plane, so that when the plane goes up, I'll nip to the loo, and then I'm going to go straight to sleep, wake up in London. So it kind of goes up, and then eventually the seatbelt sign goes, I get out of my seat, go to the loo, someone's beating me to it. It's like, a bit annoyed. It's like 20 to 1 now, so I've got to wait outside. The purser comes up to me, and he's, hello, I don't really want to socialize. It's 20 to 1. I'm tired. I've preached all day. I've preached all week. I want to go home. And he's, were you on work or holiday? I said, it was work. He goes, what do you do? Oh, no. I don't want to. So I gave him the short version. I'm a motivational speaker for behavioral alteration. He said, well, I must speak with you. I said, no, not now. I don't need to go to the... And at that point, someone came out. I said, I need to go to the toilet. And I go in, and I come out, and I'm thinking, right, okay, I'll just walk straight past him so I can go to sleep. And I come out. He's standing waiting for me. I must speak to you. He grabs my hand, and we're walking. He's showing me to another little place on the aeroplane where we could sit and talk. He says, you must help me. Let me tell you my problems. So he starts telling me his problems. And I thought, I can't do this. I'm tired. And I thought, oh, Lord, we've got to speed this up. So I said, listen, stop. I said, do you believe in God? He said, no, I'm a free thinker. I said, there's nothing free about your thinking. I said, I will pray for you because I believe in God. So I put my hand on his heart, and inside, I didn't do the Pentecostal stuff. Inside, I said, Jesus, I'm so knackered. I feel tired. I need to go to sleep. I really can't do this. Please, could you just accelerate this? Just move, you know, just do it. Anyway, and then I said, amen. And he went, woo! What is it? I said, it's Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit. I said, yeah, Holy Spirit. I said, listen, I'll go to sleep. I'll see you later. So I try and sleep. You know what it's like on a plane, you sleep 4 hours. I woke up. My wife's here. This is a true story. I'm not being evangelistic. I woke up. He's standing there. Mr. John, we must speak. So he takes me back to that little private place in the aeroplane. We talk, tell him about Jesus, tell him about the Alpha course, tell him about that. I didn't like, I'm going to fly to London on the midnight flight. Let me find a non-Christian. No, you just be yourself. They're everywhere. Our responsibility as Christians is to go into God's orchard. God's orchard is the earth. And what do? We check the fruit. If the fruit is ripe for picking, what do? You pick it, because if you don't pick the fruit that's right for picking, one of two things happens. One, it overripes, falls to the ground, and dies. Or two, the Jehovah's Witnesses pick it. So while we Christians are faffing about, playing with our belly buttons, trying to get the fluff out of them, everyone else is picking the fruit. And if the fruit's not right for picking, what do? You shine the sun of righteousness on it. Evangelism should be a priority. We shouldn't even have to be saying that. Why should we even be having to say that? It's in the scriptures. It's what theology is all about. Theology should motivate us to reach the lost. If it doesn't, to me, it has absolutely no value. Theology is there for us to encounter the true and living God so that we can reach others. That's it. That's what London School Theology should be about. That's what the church should be about. That's what we should be about. Make it a priority. Live it. Live and breathe Jesus, because we are carriers of his presence. We're carriers of his presence. The same power that raised Jesus from the dead lives in us. Wow. Wow. That would be a good thing to unpack for a whole week at London School of Theology, wouldn't it? Whoa. You're telling me the same power that raised Jesus from the dead lives in me? Well, if the same power that raised Jesus from the dead lives in me, surely someone should notice. So, I mean, there's a lot of power in here, isn't there? There's a lot of power in here. I mean, I am theologically charged up. I am a hot dude. What's in here can raise dead people. What lives in here can raise dead people? Yeah. If it can raise dead people, it can do anything. Wow. Let's get our theology right. That's why I love theology. But let's have theology on fire. Let's carry the fire of Jesus to other people. There were two Jewish friends. One said to the other, "How are you?" He goes, "I'm not good." "Why are you not good?" He goes, "My son, he's become a Christian." His other friend said, "Oh, it's funny you should say that. My son too, he's become a Christian." "Yeah. Oh, what should we do?" "So let's go and see the rabbi." So they went to see the rabbi. Rabbi, we've come to you because we have problems." The rabbi says, "What are your problems?" They said, "Our sons, they've become Christians." The rabbi goes, "Oh, it's funny you should say that. My son too, he's become a Christian." Yeah. "What do we do, rabbi?" Rabbi thinks. "Let's go to the chief rabbi." "Chief rabbi, we've come to you. We have serious problems." Chief rabbi says, "What are your problems?" "All of our sons, they've all become Christians." The chief rabbi goes, "Oh, it's funny you should say that. My son too, he's become a Christian." They go, "No, yes. Chief rabbi, what do we do?" Chief rabbi thinks, "In a situation like this, we bow down to Yahweh and we call on the name of Yahweh." So they bow down, Yahweh, "we come to you with our problems." They heard from heaven. "What are your problems?" They said, "All of our sons, they've all become Christians." And then they heard from heaven, "It's funny you should say that." God had one son. His son was a missionary. Our ministry, our little ministry based in Chorleywood, we booked the Emirates Football Stadium for the 8th of July, 2017. Why? Because we want over 40,000 people to come there. We want 20,000 Christians to each bring one friend. We've got Hillsong leading worship. We've got Matt Redmond leading worship. We've got Noel Tredinnick putting together a 1,000 children's choir that are going to sing two songs. We've got people going to testify from all walks of life, and I'm going to preach the gospel. That's £1 million. That's quite a lot, actually. Sometimes I do get a little bit nervous. Just a little bit nervous. Jesus was in the Gerasenes, and there was a man who was battling with demons. And Jesus cast out the demons into 2,000 pigs. They ran down a hill into a lake and they drowned. I said to Susie last Tuesday, "Susie, find out for me how much 2,000 pigs would cost if we bought them today." So she researches how much 2,000 pigs would cost if we bought them today. Fully grown pigs. 2,000 would cost £500,000. Jesus sacrificed 2,000 pigs to help one man. In other words, one man is worth more than 2,000 pigs. In other words, one man is worth more than the local economy. How much are we willing to invest to reach lost people? Well, we're having a go. William Carey's motto, expect great things from God, attempt great things for God. We're going to have a go. We've booked the Emirates. If you live in London, become a partner. Support us. Book the date in your diary, 8th of July, 2017. Bring a plus one. It could be a significant link in the chain. We're thinking of 20,000 guests. Could you at least think about 10 friends, family, neighbors, and colleagues? And just start praying, caring, sharing, and see what God may do. Thank you to LST. Please forgive me if I've upset you. I hope you will receive my passion for evangelism, not so much as a rebuke, but as an exhortation for you to reevaluate your curriculum for the future. Thank you to Deo Gloria for sponsoring this lecture and for having a passion and a heart for evangelism. Thank you. And thank you to all of you for taking the time to come. And my prayer and my hope is that you've been inspired and encouraged and feel motivated that, yes, evangelism must always be a priority. In the words of the prophet Nike, just do it.